equal amount of linear algebra also, but as well as group theory. So let's see what is this problem. Like let G be a finite group of order n greater than or equal to 2. Okay, then justify. So justify means if it is true, you have to give a proof. If it is false, you have to give an example. So the options are, there always exists an injective homomorphism from the group G to the symmetric group on n symbols. Okay. Second option is, there always exists an injective homomorphism from G to SM for some m less than n. Option is, there always exists an injective homomorphism from the group G to GL and R, set of all n by n real invertible real matrices. So like, anybody did this problem in group theory in our workshop? I hope no, right?
No, we don't do it.
Okay, great. Okay. So what is the answer to this problem? What is your what do you think about each of the options? Which one you think it is correct? So can you think of any theorem from your first theory course that is related to?
We can say every finite group is embedded in permutation groups. So from that, I think A of B, so there is always an injective homomorphism.
Okay, but G is a group of order n. Okay, but they are saying that there existed in they are saying G can be embedded inside Sn. This n also equal to the finite group of order n. So even a finite group G, you can embed inside some symmetric group Sk. The question is whether this k, whether can it be equal to n, where cardinality of G equal to n. That is the question. So it is possible k equal to n. Okay, so you know the name, what name of the theorem?
Cayley's theorem.
Yeah, so it is called Cayley's theorem. Okay, so let's quickly see the importance of this problem. First, suppose I have a homomorphism F from a group G1 to G2. Okay, so we say that F is a isomorphism between the group G1 and G2 if one is F is 1-1, second F is onto, on top of it, first as a zeroth condition, F is a group homomorphism. Okay. Homomorphism. So if a group satisfies this condition, then we say that G1 is isomorphic to G2. Okay, but what happens sometime is G1 may not be isomorphic to G2. Okay, suppose say this is my group G1, this is my group G2. So what happens is this G1 and G2 may not be isomorphic, but what happens is inside G1, you can find a subgroup H such that this G1 and H, these two groups are isomorphic. Okay, so G1 and G2 are not isomorphic, but there exists a subgroup H of G2 such that H is isomorphic to G1 or G1 is isomorphic to H. So why this is important? Because inside G2 you have a copy of G1. Okay, so now suppose you are given a group, suppose you are given two groups, one is G1 and G2, how to prove that there is a copy of G1 inside G2? So that is what is that's the important thing. So suppose G1 sits inside G2. So this is the copy of G1. That means that this G1 and H, they are isomorphic. If it is the case, then you can find the group homomorphism. Okay. So if there exists a H subgroup of G2 such that G1 is isomorphic to H, this implies there exists a homomorphism F from G1 to H such that F is homomorphism. So F satisfies the conditions 1, 2, and 3. Okay. So if G1 and H are isomorphic, then you can find a homomorphism from G1 to H satisfying these three conditions. Okay, I gave 0, 1, 2, so maybe I'll change here 0, 1. So satisfying 0, 1, and 2. This is possible. Okay. So if G2 has a copy of G1, from G1 to G2, you may not have a bijection, which is homomorphism. But from what happens is there exists a homomorphism. There exists a homomorphism F from G1 to G2. First condition is F is homomorphism. Second is F is 1, 1. Okay, so even so now this homomorphism F maps G1 to H. Okay, and it is an isomorphism between G1 and H. So if it is an isomorphism, it has to 1, 1. Okay, but we are defining map from G1 to G2, but G1 and H is isomorphic. That means that the image of G1 is H. Okay, so this function need not be onto. As a function from G1 to G2, this F is not onto, because if you take an element outside H, these elements will not have free image. But if you take an element inside H, it will have a free image here. Okay, therefore, if so third condition is image of F is equal to H. Okay. So if G2 contains a copy of G1, you can find a homomorphism which is injective, whose image is H. Okay. So in this case, we have G1 is isomorphic to H, which is a subgroup of G2. Okay. So this is what important to this problem. So in the problem, they are saying that there always exists an injective homomorphism from G to S1. Okay. So suppose this is my G and this is my Sn. Okay. Suppose there exists an injective homomorphism from G to Sn. And say, let's call this homomorphism F. Say this is image of the function F. If this is image of F, then this image, say call this image H, then since the image is a image of a homomorphism and of a group, we have H is a subgroup of Sn. That is the first thing. Second thing, G is isomorphic to H. Okay, because F is a homomorphism. It is given that F is an injective homomorphism. Now we are looking at the image. Therefore, so as a function F from G to H, it will be an isomorphism. So we get G is H. Okay. So they are saying that there always exists an injective homomorphism from G to Sn. That is same as saying that Sn has a copy of G inside Sn. That is a question. Okay. So the first option says that given a group G of order N, Sn has a copy of G. In other words, every group of order G is a subgroup of Sn. That's how you should understand the first option. Okay. Note that this is an arbitrary finite group of order N. And they are saying that there always exists an injective homomorphism from G to Sn. So if there exists an injective homomorphism from G to Sn, means that Sn has a copy of G as a subgroup. But this group is an arbitrary group of order N. So we conclude that inside the group Sn, all the group of order N will be there as a subgroup. That is the very important result, and that is true. So that result is called Kayle's theorem in group theory. So we quickly see the statement. So we don't need a finite group. So we can take like G be an arbitrary group. Then G is isomorphic to a subgroup of S subscript G. Okay, now we have to define what is S subscript G. S subscript G means set of all function F from G to G such that F is a bijection. So now in this statement, let's take G to be a group of order N. Suppose order of G equal to N, then this statement says that G is isomorphic to a subgroup H of S subscript G. Okay, so G is isomorphic to a subgroup of S subscript G. Okay, now S subscript G means that I just wrote the definition. S subscript G means a set of all bijections from G to G. Now we have assumed the cardinality of G equal to N, and we have one small result. The proof is immediate. So you take two sets. A and B are two sets of equal cardinality. So we are not assuming it is finite, but equal cardinality. Even if it is an infinite set, if A is countably infinite, then B also should be, so if A has cardinality L of naught, B also should have cardinality L of naught. If A has cardinality C, B also should have cardinality C, and so on so forth. Okay, then SA is a group isomorphic to SB. In particular, if cardinality of A equal to N, then S subscript A is isomorphic to SN. For example, you take A to be the set 1, 2, A to be the set ABC. Okay, then S subscript A is equal to set of all F from A comma B comma C to A comma B comma C such that F is a bijection, right? But what is SN? S3 for in this case, S3 equal to set of all function F from 1, 2, 3 to 1, 2, 3 such that F is a bijection. So since we are assuming A and B has same cardinality, doesn't matter, like you are looking at bijection from ABC to ABC or 1, 2, 3 to 1, 2, 3, doesn't matter, the elements are exactly same. Same means you can identify the elements. For example, suppose you have this bijection. So usually we write the bijections like this. So ABC to ABC, A goes to B, B goes to C, C goes to A. This is an example of a bijection from the set ABC to another set ABC. This bijection can be identified with 1, 2, 3 goes to 2, 3, 1, right? So 2, 3, 1. So what matters is like how many elements are there? Three elements are there. That's what matters, okay? So we conclude that if A and B have same cardinality, then the group SA is isomorphic to SB, okay? So now we'll use this result to prove the Kayles theorem, okay? So by Kayles, let me write the Kayles theorem again. So G is arbitrary group, then G is isomorphic to a group H, which is subgroup of SG. In particular, if cardinality of G equal to N, if cardinality of G equal to N, then SG is isomorphic to SN. So if cardinality of G equal to N, then SG is isomorphic to SN. That is the result we just saw. If cardinality of A equal to N, then the set of all bijection from A to A is isomorphic to set of all bijection from 1 to N to 1 to N. That is what symmetric group. So we get SG is isomorphic to SN and G is isomorphic to H subgroup of SN. Okay. So this is just the statement of Kayles theorem. So Kayles theorem states that G is isomorphic to a subgroup of SG, but SG and SN are isomorphic. Therefore, G is isomorphic to a subgroup of SN. In place of SG, we can replace SN. Okay. So we get the first option is correct. Is there any doubt in the first option? So you take any finite group, there always exists an injective homomorphism from G to SN. This is precisely Kayles theorem statement. Okay, so please check the proof of Kayles theorem in topics in algebra in history. It is a very interesting and a simple proof. Okay. Yes. So the option A is fine. Is there any doubt?
No.
Okay. So if you have some doubts, please ask me. Like maybe many of you might have seen it for the first time. So I'll share the notes. You please check in the notes. Okay. Okay. So second option, there always exists an injective homomorphism from G to Sm for some m less than n. So in the first option, we just saw that G is isomorphic to a subgroup H. G is isomorphic to a subgroup of Sn. Right. This is what we saw. Now they are asking. So here we assume that cardinality of G equal to n. If cardinality of G equal to n, then G is isomorphic to a subgroup of Sn. Now again, we assume cardinality of G equal to n. But the question is, can you embed G in some symmetric group smaller than Sn? So for some m less than n, can you embed G? Or does there exist an injective homomorphism from G to Sn for some m strictly less than n? For m equal to n, we know the answer. That is true. That is a Cayley's theorem. For m less than n, is it possible? So what do you think? Anybody have some counter example for this result? Like this is false.
Sir, if we choose a Klein's 4 group K4, then from K4 to S3, there is no injective homomorphism. Because if there is an injective homomorphism, then image of K4 would be a subgroup of S3, and image of K4 is a group of order 4. And S3 has no subgroup of order 4.
Okay, yeah, that is a very simple and elegant. Yeah, maybe I'll just explain. So we take G to be K4. So K4 means K4, another name is B4, the Klein 4 group of order 4. So it has elements E, A, B, C, and the multiplication is A square equal to B square equal to C square equal to identity, and A, B equal to C. Okay, so this is an abelian group. This is how multiplication is defined. You can easily form the Cayley table. So please check what is Klein 4 group. It is a very interesting group. It will be useful to give counter example in many problems. For example, this is an example of an abelian group which is not cyclic. Okay, so it is a group of order 4 and it is abelian but not cyclic. Anyway, so what we are claiming is Klein. There exists no injective homomorphism from K4 has order 4. So there will be an injective homomorphism from K4 to S4. That is the Cayley's theorem. But here we are claiming that from K4 to S3, there will not be any injective homomorphism. Reason is because if there is an injective homomorphism from K4 to S3, that means that K4 is isomorphic to a subgroup of S3. But K4 is a group of order 4, but S3, like cardinality of S3 is 6, right? And 4 is not a divisor of 6. This implies S3 has no subgroup of order 6 by Cayley's theorem. By Lagrange's theorem, order of a subgroup should divide order of the group. Okay. So if K4 is isomorphic to a subgroup of S3, then that subgroup should have order 4. But by Lagrange's theorem, 4 should divide 6. That is not possible. Therefore, since S3 has no subgroup of order 4, okay, so this is the reason. What is our claim? There exists no injective homomorphism from K4 to S3 because cardinality of S3 equal to 6 and 4 doesn't divide 6. Therefore, S3 has no subgroup of order 6. Okay, since S3 has no subgroup of order 6, we get that there exists no injective homomorphism from K4 to S3. Okay. But what is exactly the second option? Like there always exists an injective homomorphism. Okay, yeah. They are saying that there always exists an injective homomorphism from G to Sm for some m. The question is for some m. Okay, so the like here so here there is a catch here, like K4 to S3 we proved that there exists no injective homomorphism. Similarly, K4 to S2 and K4 to S1 we have to say that here also there will not be injective homomorphism, okay, because for some m less than n, that is a very important thing. For some m less than n means 1, 2, etc., m minus 1. All the numbers we have to discuss. But again, it is very, for the same reason, it is very easy. So definitely K4 is not inside S3 because S3 has no subgroup of order 4. S3 cannot have a subgroup of order 4. Now, again, K4 cannot embed inside S2 because S2 itself has two elements. S2 is cardinality of S2 is 2 factorial, cardinality of S1 is 1 factorial. There are two elements here, one element. So a group of order 2 or a group of order 1 cannot contain a group of order 4 as a subgroup. Okay. So this option also false. Therefore, second option is false. Okay. But I think I remember there is a much simpler example. Can anyone think of some much simpler example than S4? What about much simpler example is so the same example is fine. Also we can think take G to be Z2. Okay, now cardinality of G equal to 2. So now there doesn't exist an injective homomorphism from Z2 to, we should not put S2 because if you put N here, so then that is Cayley's theorem. So there will be an injective homomorphism from group of order N to Sn. But in this option, we are looking at M strictly less than N. So we have to put S1, right? But S1 is like just the identity element. But this has two elements. So from a two element group to one element group, you will not have an injective homomorphism. So trivially, this is true. Okay, so K4 is also fine. Z2 is also fine. Okay, so let's come to the linear algebra. Third option is what I'm very interested in. Like, we take an arbitrary group of order N, N greater than or equal to 2. They're saying that there always exists an injective homomorphism from G to GLN, GLN of R. So anybody have some idea about this option C? So G is isomorphic. G is isomorphic to H, where H is a subgroup of GLN of R. Why?
Because suppose G has a group of order N. Then we can find an element in GLN of R whose order is N.
You proceed. Yeah, we can find an element of order N in GLNR and
we can find a one correspondence between element of order N in G to element of order N in GLNR.
But G need not have an element of order N. G is not a cyclic group. So in case of cyclic group, your argument is correct. So you're understanding my point? Suppose G is a cyclic group. But you are almost there. Can you modify your argument so that it works? Your argument is perfectly fine. You just need to do one more step.
Sir, if we can find an injective homomorphism from G to Sn, and Sn, if we represent every permutation by matrix representation, then it has n by n invertible matrix.
Right. So what is it like? What to say?
We can use such a because
yes,
we can
so
connect.
That is what. Yeah. So that is the thing. So I was coming to ask you about the name of the matrices that is called permutation matrices. Okay. So by option A, G is isomorphic to a a group, yes, a subgroup of Sn. Okay, so what we do, Sn is isomorphic to Pn, where Pn is a subgroup of GLnR. Pn is set of all n by n permutation matrices. So I will define what is Pn. So then Sn and Pn are isomorphic. Okay, so we get G is isomorphic to a subgroup of Sn, and Sn is isomorphic to Pn, where Pn is a subgroup of GLnR. Okay, so not just GLnR, you can take any field F. Okay, so a permutation matrix is a matrix with entries 0 and 1 only. Every field has 0 and 1. So doesn't matter which field you are looking at, a set of all n by n invertible matrices, over any field you can consider, Pn will be there, set of all permutation matrices will be there. So now you see, G is an arbitrary group of order n. It is isomorphic to a subgroup of Sn by Kayle's theorem. And this subgroup is, Sn is isomorphic to set of all permutation matrices. And this is subgroup, this is actually a subgroup of GLnR. So subgroup is a transitivity relation. H is a subgroup of K, K is a subgroup of G, then H is a subgroup of G. That one can verify directly. Therefore, G is isomorphic to a subgroup of GLnR. Okay, so that is the main result. So what is Pn? So Pn is a very, very important concept for exams. So set of all n by n permutation matrices. So anybody did permutation matrices in the class? Or should I define? Anybody, any idea?
No, sir, we don't have lecture on this.
Okay, so quickly see what is permutation matrix.
Identity matrix with row exchanged.
Row interchanged.
Yes.
According to the
corresponding to
row
corresponding to each permutation, we can associate
Right. Can find it through the group action that will give us more combinatorial.
Yeah, that is true, but maybe many people may not be comfortable with the group action. So maybe I'll just write what is directly. So we do 3x3 case. So S3 has 6 elements. These are the 6 permutations in S3. So first, 1, 2, 3 goes to 1, 2, 3. This is identity. Then 1, 2, 3 goes to 2, 1, 3. This is the 1, 2 cycle. Then 1, 2, 3 goes to 3, 2, 1. This is this 1, 3 cycle. Then 1, 2, 3 goes to 1, 3, 2. This is 2, 3 cycle. Then 1, 2, 3 goes to 2, 3, 1. This is the 1, 2, 3, 3 cycle. Then 1, 3, sorry. 1, 2, 3, 1, 3, 2, 1. Am I right? 1 goes to 3. Oh, sorry. No. 1 goes to 3. 2 goes to 1. 3 goes to 2. 3, 2, 1. Correct? Yeah, 3, 2, 1. So these are the 6 permutations in the symmetry group on 3 symbols. Now, what do? You take 3x3 identity matrix. 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0. Okay. Sorry. This is 3x3 identity matrix. Now here we are going to permute the columns. You can permute the rows also, doesn't matter. So like rows or columns, like it is a little bit, you need to be a little careful, but as far as for this problem, we don't need to be worry about anything. Anyway, so here what we do, 1 goes to 2, 2 goes to 1, 3 goes to 3, right? So here, 1 and 2 are interchanged. So somebody is unmuted your mic. Please, can you please mute? Yeah, thank you. So in this permutation, 1 and 2 is interchanged and 3 is fixed. So what we do, we fix the third column to itself. Okay. So third column, we are not changing. It just to put it. Now 1 and 2 are interchanged. So we interchange the first and the second column. So we get 0 1 0 1 0 0. Okay, so for each permutation we can apply the permutation in the columns of a matrix. Okay, so the symmetry group acts on the identity matrix like as a group action, like by permuting the columns. So for example, here second column is fixed because 2 goes to 2. So we write 0, 1, 0, second column. So in the identity matrix, second column remains the same. So you have to act these permutations on the identity matrix. Okay, so that is important. Then first column and the third column interchanged. So 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 0. Okay. So similarly, this is 1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0. This is 0, 1, 0. So 1 goes to 2, like 2 goes to 3. So 0, 0, 1, then 3 goes to 1, 1, 0, 0. And 1, 3, like 0, 0, 1, 0, sorry. 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0. Okay. So these six matrices are called permutation matrices. These matrices satisfy the special property. Every row and every column has exactly only one one. Okay. So you take any of these matrices, if you consider any row or any column, it will have exactly only one one. So it is a 0-1 matrix satisfying this particular condition. And these are the only matrices that satisfy this condition. Okay. Now this is the isomorphism. Like you can verify that these six matrices separate, these six matrices, we call it P3. This P3 form a subgroup of GL3 of R. Okay, so it is a straightforward computation. You can just prove that it is closed under it, multiplication, and you verify the axioms. So these six elements form a group. In general, if you consider Sn, there will be n factorial permutations. For each permutation, you can associate a matrix like this. These matrices are called permutation matrices. So many properties of the permutation matrices can be obtained by using the permutation. Since the group Sn and Pn are isomorphic, so we have many advantages. So that I will explain next. Now, so like for this reason, Sn is isomorphic to Pn, where Pn is a subgroup of GLn. So therefore, at least the third option is correct. Like for this reason, third option is correct. So there always exists an injective homomorphism from G to GLnR. So for example, so I will go one more. We go one step further. Anyway, so here G to Sn, you have injective homomorphism from Sn to GLnR. From G to Sn, you have an injective homomorphism. Sn to Pn, you have an isomorphism. From Pn to GLnR, you have an injective homomorphism. Okay, now this is injective, this is isomorphism, this is injective. If you compose all the three, you will get an injective homomorphism from G to GLnR. Okay, so think about it. So third option is also true. But as I said, one more step is true. There exists an okay, we assume order of G equal to A. G is a group of order N. Okay. Now, there exists an invertible group homomorphism from G to SLN. SLM of R for some M. So for some M, I'm not saying this N and this M should be same. So what about this result? So SLM for me, so GLN of R, we know. GLN of R is set of all A belongs to M and R, set of all N by N real matrices such that determinant of A is not equal to 0. Now SLM of R is set of all A belongs to M and R or GLN of R such that determinant of A equal to 1. Okay. So if you consider all the determinant on matrices, that will form a group. Actually, that will form a subgroup of GLNR. Actually, that will form a normal subgroup of GLNR. Okay. Okay, so we'll come to the normality next, but for the time being, so what about this option, whether it is true or false, what do you think? So for this, what we do, let's look at the permutation matrices. Okay, so suppose if all these matrices has determinant 1, okay, so then what happens is, so what I'm claiming is not true. Okay, these matrices, all these matrices is not going to have determinant 1. So anybody know what is the determinant of a permutation matrix?
Plus or minus 1.
Yeah, when it will be plus 1, when it will be minus 1.
Minus 1 to the power n.
Minus 1 to the power floor function of n.
No, that is not true. Minus 1 power number of transpositions, or the determinant itself is a sign. Determinant equal to sign of the permutation. Anyway, let's see. I will explain that. So if you look at this permutation, every permutation can be written as product of transpositions. For example, you take 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 5, 4, 3, 1, 2, 7, 6. So this is a permutation. Let's say write it as product of cycles. So 1 goes to 7 goes to 6 goes to 1, then 2 goes to 2, then 3 goes to 5 goes to 3, 4 goes to 4. So 1, 7, 6, 3, 5. This is a cycle decomposition, right? So this is a 3-cycle and a 2-cycle. Now you have to write it as a transposition. Transposition means 2 cycles. So this can be written as 1, 7, 1, 6, and 3, 5. So there are 3 transpositions. Therefore, let's call this permutation sigma. Then we say sigma is a odd permutation because there are odd number of transpositions. Sigma is a odd permutation. Okay, so sigma is odd permutation because there are odd number of transpositions, and we define sine of sigma is equal to minus 1 power number of transpositions. Okay, number of transposition, this is equal to minus 1 power 3, which is equal to minus 1. Okay. So what do you do? If you remember, there is one CSIR problem. Let me quickly state that problem. Like A equal to 1, 1, 1, 1, etc. 1, right? So this is the matrix given. So everywhere else it is 0, but it is not given 0. So it is understood that only along this diagonal it is 1. Okay. Then determinant of A is, what is determinant of A? That is the question. Okay. So basically, this is a permutation matrix because in every row and every column, you will have exactly 1, 1, other entries are 0. Therefore, it is a permutation matrix. So what you have to do, you have to find the corresponding, permutation. Okay, so if it's a n by n, so for example, if it is a, say it is a 5 by 5 matrix, okay. So if it is a 5 by 5 matrix, then it will be looks like this. 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. So the remaining places are 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0. So it is a 5, if it is a 5 by 5 matrix, it will be looks like this, okay. So now, in place of first column, you have the fifth column. So this is the E5, right? In the identity matrix, this column will come at the last place. So you can read out the permutation from this matrix. So one, in place of 1, you have 5. In place of 2, you have 4. In place of 3, you have 3. In place of 4, you have 2. In place of 5, you have 1. So in place of first column, you have 5. In place of second column, you have 4. In place of third column, you have 3. In place of fourth column, you have 2. In the first fifth column, you have 1. So it is easy to read the permutation from the permutation matrix. Now finding the determinant of this 5x5 matrix may be like it is time consuming. It is a part B problem. Okay, but calculating the sign of this permutation is easy because this is 1, 5, 2, 4. This is the cycle decomposition, product of permutations, transpositions. So there are 2 transpositions. Therefore, sign of sigma equal to -1 power number of transposition, that is 1. Therefore, this matrix has determinant 1. Okay. But this is asked for n-by-n matrix. So n-by-n matrix means you should do some more work. But using the same idea, we can do. Okay. So determinant of a permutation matrix is equal to the sign of the corresponding permutation. So in some exam, if they are giving a huge matrix, 0-1 matrix, and if you are asked to find the determinant, always check whether it is a permutation matrix. If it is a permutation matrix, then the answer is very simple. You can just look at the corresponding permutation's sign. Okay, so that is one idea. But anyway, so this Pn,
sir, is the subgroup of n by n matrix. What is the answer?
That problem I have already solved in the so can you check in the channel?
Okay.
Yeah, so it's very simple actually. So the answer is -1 power floor n by 2.
Because when n is odd, then we get 1, and when n is even, we get the odd number of
transpositions. Yeah. Right. So, as he's suggesting, so I have done for 5 by 5, right? So, you do for 1 by 1, 2 by 2, 3 by 3, 4 by 4, and you list out the determinant. Okay. So, it is very easy to list out the determinant. So, from this determinant, you can guess the nth term of the sequence. That is very easy to guess the nth term of the sequence. This problem I have solved in the YouTube channel, like you can check that. Okay. So anyway, yeah. So I carried away from what I prepared actually. So if I thought I would do it today, I would have shared the link here itself. Maybe I will share in the WhatsApp group, our group. Anyway, so the point is, this Pn is not a subgroup of SLNR. If all these matrices has determinant 1, that will mean that the Pn is a subgroup of SLNR, and we are done, because H is a subgroup of Pn, sorry, G is isomorphic to a subgroup of Sn, Sn isomorphic to Pn, Pn is subgroup of SLNR, and we are done. But that is not true, okay, because Pn consists of matrices of determinant -1 also. So that will not work, but there is a much simpler solution than this. Quickly I will say one more fact that you can check by yourself. So these results are very important. I will share the proof of this proof of these facts in the YouTube channel, in our WhatsApp. So determinant of A subscript sigma. So A subscript sigma means the permutation matrix corresponds to the permutation sigma. This is equal to sign of the permutation sigma. Similarly, what is trace of A sigma? Trace of the permutation matrix. That is equal to fixed points of sigma. Number of fixed points of sigma. So for example, let's look at this matrix. So here the trace is 3, because everything is fixed. 1 goes to 1, 2 goes to 2, 3 goes to 3. Here the trace is 1, because only 3 is fixed. Here trace is 1, because 2 is fixed. Here trace is 1, because only 1 is fixed. Here trace is 0, because none of them is fixed. Everything is moved to some other number. So here also trace is zero because no number is fixed. Okay. So so there is a CSI problem. One of the option is the trace of A sigma equal to number of fixed points. Okay. So that is why it is important. Anyway, let's look at how to embed G inside SLM of R. So G is a group of order n. Then,
so what is the meaning of embedding?
So embedding means so this is my G. I am embedding inside G prime, means that inside G prime I can find a H such that G is isomorphic to H. So embedding means inside G I am putting G. Okay, embedding. In other words, embedding means there exists an injective homomorphism. Homomorphism F from G to G prime. Okay, so if there is an injective homomorphism from G to G prime, means if you look at the image from, so this image, this is the image. Okay, so this image and G will be isomorphic. In other words, G prime contains a copy of G. Okay. So one simple example is like,
sir,
again, we
G
can look at
the HR G to G prime, sir.
G to G prime. So it is not surjective, it is only injective. The image will be H.
Okay.
Is it clear? I'll give an example. Yes. Then it okay, let's take Z3. Z3 is 0, 1, 2 with respect to addition modulo 3. Okay. Now let's take S3. S3, I just wrote the 6 elements. So consider A3. A3 consists of even permutations. So even permutations are identity, then 1, 2, 3, then 1, 3, 2. Okay. So now I claim that this S3 can be embedded inside S3. Okay, so how? So inside S3, you will take only this A3. Okay, then what happens is you can find a, so suppose this is my S3, you can find a isomorphism between Z3 to A3. So what is that isomorphism? We define F from Z3 to S3 by F of 1 equal to 1, 2, 3, the 3 cycle. F of 2 equal to 1, 3, 2. Then identity should goes to identity. F of 0 equal to identity. Okay. So this is a group homomorphism, injective group homomorphism from Z3 to S3. Okay. It is injective but not surjective. Okay. Because there are only 3 elements, so this is 6 elements, so there cannot be any surjective map. But if you look at the image consists of these 3 elements, that is a subgroup. Okay, Z3 and S3, they are not isomorphic, but Z3 and this image of this map, A3, they are isomorphic. Okay, so inside S3, I can embed Z3 as A3. Okay, so this Z3 and A3 are 2 isomorphic groups, only names are different. Okay, so this is what is called embedding. Okay, inside a bigger group we are identifying a smaller group, so that is the idea. Is it clear now?
Clear, sir.
Yeah, so anyway, now okay, let's do. Okay, so G is a group of order n. What we know is G is isomorphic to a H. H is a subgroup of SN or a PN, permutation matrices. And PN is a subgroup of, okay, we don't, I mean, let's just write directly. So we know that G is isomorphic to a subgroup of GL and R. So suppose GL and R is isomorphic to a subgroup H of some SLM of R. then we are done, right? Hello. So we climb. We climb that. So somebody has unmuted your mic. So we claim that GL and R is isomorphic to a subgroup of SL n plus 1 of R. Okay, n plus 1 of R. Again, this problem is also asked in the previous year, like maybe when it is 18, I think. 18th CSR problem. So GL and R is isomorphic to a subgroup of SLN plus 1 of R. Okay, so G you can put inside GL and R, therefore you can put inside SLN plus 1 of R also. So what is the argument? So we are going to form a N by so we take a belongs to GL and of R. Okay, and so this is my GLN of R. I want to put this inside SLN plus 1 of R. SLN plus 1 of R. Okay. So what I do, I take a matrix here. For each matrix here, I will associate a matrix here such that the association is injective and group homomorphism. Okay. Then GLN R will be isomorphic to a subgroup of SLN plus 1 R. So that is our usual idea. Same idea only we're going to use here also. Okay. So what we do, I take a n by n invertible matrix. I want to construct a n plus 1 cross n plus 1 matrix whose determinant is 1. Okay. So what we do, I have an n by n matrix, right? So this is my first column. This is my first column. This is my first row. This is my A11 entry. Okay. Then all these places I am putting 0. How many entries will be there? How many entries are here?
N
entries. All these N entries I am putting 0. Again, here also we will have N entries. I put 0 here. Now, size of this matrix is a N by N matrix. Correct? This is N plus 1 by N plus 1. I take one row, one column. So, this is a N by N matrix. In this N by N place, I put A. So I have a n by n invertible matrix. That matrix I put here. Okay. So this is a n plus 1 cross n plus 1 matrix. So, but this matrix won't work because I don't know whether this matrix has a determinant 1. So how to make this matrix determinant equal to 1?
Convert A 11 into 1 by determinant of A.
Right. So put A11 equal to 1 by determinant of A. So you change this entry. So this entry is equal to 1 by determinant of A. Okay. So now if we expand the determinant of this matrix, you expand along the first row. So determinant will be this entry times, you have to calculate this minor. Okay. This minor is determinant of A. So A11 times determinant of A. That's it. That is the determinant of the n plus 1 by n plus 1 matrix because all these entries are 0. Okay. But A11 is 1 by determinant of A. So 1 by determinant of A. So this determinant of A, when you multiply, you will get 1. Okay. So if you choose this A11 to be 1 by determinant of A, you will get a determinant 1 matrix. Okay. So we call this matrix A delta. Okay. So we define F from GL and R to SLN plus of SLN plus 1 of R, SLN plus 1 of R, A goes to A delta. Okay, then we have to verify that these matrices are, this is a group homomorphism, second is one injective. So, but if two matrices are different, if A and B are two different matrices, then A delta and B delta will be different because this block will vary, right? If A not equal to B, then the corresponding matrices, this block will be different. therefore the A delta not equal to B delta, therefore it will be injective. So you can just directly verify that it is a group homomorphism. Okay, so you have to use the fact that this determinant is multiplicative. Determinant of AB equal to determinant of A times determinant of B. Okay, so what we get? So if you start with a group of order N, arbitrary group of order N, this is isomorphic to a subgroup of SN. SN is isomorphic to PN. PN is a subgroup of GLNR. And GLNR is isomorphic to a subgroup of, GLNR is isomorphic to a subgroup of SL N plus 1 of R. Okay, so that is the moral of the story. Anyway, so it is very, I mean, using this itself, there are many problems in the previous year problem. So I thought I will do this. Yeah. Okay. So any doubts?
Yes, sir. We can embed Sn in Sn plus 1, right? By fixing a last element.
Right.
So through that, since we can, and also Sn plus 1 is isomorphic to Pn plus 1. Okay, that's the problem, because the probability, it has a only depending on the determinant is minus 1 also permutation matrices.
Right.
And so
what is the question?
My question was I was going through, since Sn is embedded in Sn plus 1, so through that I'm going to embed the GLN, because Sn plus 1 also has a subgroup in GLN. Through that, I was going to embed in SLM plus 1, but that cannot be happened because it has a determinant only 1, right?
Yes, correct. I understand your point. But what is interesting is...
Can I connect it with the orthogonal matrices? That's what I was going
to say. Oh, orthogonal matrices.
Yeah, because it has a determinant plus minus 1, yeah?
Right. Yeah. So I think that may not be possible, I think. Yeah, but it is what groups can be embedded inside matrix group? It is a well-studied topic. Like, you can just directly check in internet whether a finite group of order N can be embedded inside an orthogonal group. But I think the answer may be very simple to state, but I can't. Inside orthogonal group, ON. G inside ON is fine, right? Permutation matrices are all orthogonal matrices.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. Yeah.
Okay. But what's important is so G is a group of order N. Then G is isomorphic to a subgroup of AM for some M. This is true. So we have embedded G inside Sn by Kallas theorem. But even you can embed inside alternating group also. Again, like if G is order N, you cannot embed inside An, but you can embed inside Am for some M. It's alternating group, because this is simple, because
N or less than N, sir.
It is actually N plus 1 again. N plus 2. Because Sn is a Sn can be embedded inside An plus 2. So if you take the symmetric group of order N, it is isomorphic to a subgroup of alternating group on N plus 2 symbols. So I think the embedding is sigma. So we define a function F from Sn to An plus 2. We need a 1-1 homomorphism. So F of sigma equal to sigma if sigma is even. Okay, if it is a even permutation in Sn, then we can just take the same permutation sigma. So that means that this is a permutation on 1 to n. This is a permutation on 1 to n plus 2. So if it is a permutation on n symbols, you can think of it as a permutation on n plus 2 symbol by fixing n plus 1 goes to n plus 1 and n plus 2 goes to n plus 2. Okay, so that way we can define f of sigma equal to sigma if sigma is even, and f of sigma equal to sigma times, so sigma times this transposition n plus 1, n plus 2, n plus 2, n plus 1. So what happens is sigma is a odd permutation. So sigma is odd. If sigma is odd, then you are adding one more transposition to it. Okay, so then it will become an even permutation. Correct. So if sigma is even, we are just take it itself. So it will go inside an. If sigma is odd, so since I'm going, that is why I'm going an plus 2. So by going to n plus 2, I have this transposition. Here odd number of transpositions are there. By putting one more transposition, I can make it even transposition. So, but one has to verify that this is also injective and the group homomorphism. Yeah. So usually, this is what more to be said. I think it is fine. Yeah. So actually, every group is isomorphic to a subgroup of even alternating group. Okay, from GLNR we went to SLNR. Similarly, we go to symmetric group to alternating group. Okay, yeah. Anyway, so this is one thing. If but like all of these things are very important for exam. Like I can think of similar problems asked in CSR exam about him. Definitely, this problem is also asked: embedding symmetric group inside alternating group. That is also there in some problems. Anyway. Regarding permutation group, what else I want to say here?
Sir, using this technique, we can find out normal groups of GLNR, right? Can we? Sometimes it asks for like SLN is only normal subgroup that we know very trivially.
SLN is a normal subgroup, that is fine, but I think finding other normal subgroup...
using this technique, yeah, that's what I was asking, because sometimes we can find out the normal subgroup of SN easily, for the smaller n, right, obviously.
For SN, only AN is a normal subgroup, right, for n greater than or equal to 3 or 4, for 5.
Yeah, 5, after that is...
Yeah, for n, so I think that may not give you a lot normal subgroups. Anyway, so what we want, okay, let's continue. So let's do some linear algebra. So let's look at GLNR again. So it is a group with respect to matrix multiplication. Okay. So these kind of problems are asked in the CSRL exam, like give an example of a like a 7x7 matrix satisfying a power 5, given example of a 7x7 matrix A satisfying A power 5 equal to identity. So 7x7 may be say real matrix satisfying A power 5 equal to I. So this is easy. Again, we can use the isomorphism between SN and PN. Okay. So isomorphic means that order of the permutation sigma is equal to order of the associated permutation matrix. Okay. So here the operation is multiplication, matrix multiplication. So if I take A belongs to GLN of R. Okay. This A has two types of order. Order. So what is the order of the matrix? N is the order, because N, if it is a N by N matrix, then we say that N is the order. Okay. But we are not interested in this order, but we are interested in this order. This is order of an element in a group. Okay, so that means that So K equal to order of the matrix A if A power K equal to identity matrix to K is the least positive integer. Satisfying one. Okay, so this is order from the group theory. Okay, so if two groups are isomorphic, then the if sigma is mapped to A sigma. A sigma means from in the identity matrix you apply the permutation sigma. Okay, for example, like we have done these examples. So this permutation is called A identity. This matrix is called A identity. This is called A12. This is called A13. This is called A23. This is called A123. This is called A132. Okay, so for each permutation, you have a permutation matrix. And what we are saying is, so this is the isomorphism between symmetry group and permutation matrices. So order of the permutation is same as order of the matrix. Okay, so that is what is very important. So if you see here, you have this condition A power K equal to identity, right? So finding the order of a matrix is same as writing it as A power K equal to E. But if you remember, in there are many problems asking about A power K equal to identity, finding a matrix. So finding a matrix satisfying A power 5 equal to I is same as finding a permutation of order 5, okay, in S7. So now they are asking the problem in 7x7 matrix, but you want A power 5 equal to I. So what you do, you take a 5 cycle. Maybe if 5 is a very easy number, let's do 12. Okay, it is possible in 12 order of a permutation in S7, can it be 12? Yeah, 3 and 4. Yeah. So like, what do? You find a permutation whose order is 12. Okay, so you take 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So this is a permutation sigma. So you take sigma to be this permutation. Then order of sigma equal to LCM of length of disjoint cycle. So LCM of 3, 4, this is equal to 12. Now you look at A sigma, then order of A sigma will be 12, because sigma and A sigma has same order, right? Therefore you will get the corresponding 7x7 matrix will have order 12. It will satisfy the condition A power 12 equal to identity. Okay. Yeah, that is one more important thing. What more? Okay, so we will move to the next problem maybe. So this is echo 11-9. Okay. So we take a 3x3 real matrix and we assume that A is non-diagonal. Okay, and P is a real polynomial such that A satisfies P and the degree of the polynomial is 3. Then justify. Justify means we have to say whether true or false. So if it is a 3x3 matrix, then it's characteristic polynomial. So P subscript A, that is what we call PA of X. Okay, P of X is the notation for characteristic polynomial. So they are saying that if A satisfies a degree 3 polynomial, then that polynomial should be constant multiple of characteristic polynomial. So second option is, if this polynomial P, if it has a complex root, then this polynomial is constant multiple of characteristic polynomial. Third option is, if the polynomial P has a complex root, then A is diagonalizable over C. So basically they are saying that characteristic polynomial is the only polynomial of degree 3 which is satisfied by A, whether it is true or false. That is the question. So what do you think, whether it is true or false?
True.
So if A is a 3 by 3 matrix, if it satisfies a polynomial of degree 3, then that P should be constant multiple of characteristic polynomial. Any idea? It's a very simple problem actually. Sorry madam, what are you saying?
It is true, sir.
Okay, it is true.
P of A is a question. P of A is a characteristic polynomial or
yes, P A is characteristic polynomial.
Sir, P of A in question.
No, not P of A. No, not P of A. Like in the polynomial P, I am substituting A. Then it is zero. P subscript A is the characteristic polynomial.
Okay, sir, since P of
A is zero. Often A and often B are true, sir.
So I define P of X like this. And this may be like, let's just clarify the notations first. This is P of X. Okay, so this is P of X is the polynomial. In place of X, I'm substituting A, then I'm getting zero. That means that A satisfies the polynomial P. Okay, so what are you saying? Which options are true?
Option A and B are true.
Okay, what about option C?
It's also true because if option A is true, then option C is actually going to be true. Because the characteristic polynomial over the C, the characteristic polynomial splits, right? P.
So right. Right. Okay. So it boils down to C whether A is true or not, right? So A is true or not?
A is true because P satisfies P annihilates the A, right? So P of right. A should divide the P. And since they have
no,
the same
P should thing. Divide the no minimal polynomial should divide P. If a matrix satisfies a polynomial P, then the minimal polynomial of A divides the polynomial P. That is the reason. So what happens is like option A is false, option B is true, option C is true.
Why is that option A is false?
Yeah, I'll explain, but I thought somebody else has some explanation for option A.
Sir, yes. I want to ask, can you repeat what they are asking? What
the question? Right, sure. So basically we have a 3 by 3 matrix, okay? Then if you look at its characteristic polynomial, that is also a degree 3 polynomial. Okay, the 3 by 3 matrix has degree 3 characteristic polynomial. Now, the matrix A satisfies some other degree 3 polynomial. Okay, so A satisfies degree 3 polynomial. Then the first options are, they're saying that if that polynomial P should be scalar multiple of characteristic polynomial. In other words, the only degree 3 polynomial satisfied by A should be scalar multiple of characteristic polynomial. That is the first option. So, yeah. So, let's see why it is wrong. The solution is simple.
Suppose we take an nilpotent matrix 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, like that, sir. Here we have minimal polynomial first row, sir.
What about 0, 1, 0, 0? Your argument, I understand.
0, 1, 0, 0. Hello?
Madam, I understand your argument. Why to go to 3 by 3? Can't we do in 2 by 2 itself? That is my question.
So we take it. 3 by 3 matrix, sir. A.
Oh, sorry. Okay. In this problem, it is given 3 by 3. That's why you're taking
3 by 3. That's why.
Okay. Anyway, fine. Yeah. But tell me. 0 0 1 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 Yeah, so you consider A to be this matrix. Okay, then minimal polynomial, MA of x equal to x, and the characteristic polynomial is x cube. Minimal polynomial is x square, right?
X square, sir.
Yeah, minimal polynomial is x square. So if you square this matrix, we will get zero. Correct. Yeah, definitely we'll get zero. So we, this is okay. So what is P? But you need a degree 3 polynomial, right? Satisfied by A, other than characteristic polynomial. You can take anything. Some x minus alpha or some ax plus b.
Right, so simply we can take x cube plus x square.
So simply what you can take?
X cube plus x square, minimal polynomial plus characteristic polynomial.
That will also work. Correct. So more generally, so if you consider this matrix 0 0 1 0 0 0 0 0 0, so it is a strictly upper triangular matrix. So its eigenvalues are 0 0 0, so therefore it is a nilpotent matrix and its all eigenvalues are 0. Therefore the characteristic polynomial is x cube. Now we want to find the minimal polynomial. Minimal polynomial means least degree polynomial satisfied by A. Okay, and the minimal polynomial should divide characteristic polynomial. Okay, so what are the polynomials that divide x cube? X, x square and x cube, these are the polynomials that divide x cube. Now this matrix won't satisfy the polynomial x, because the only matrix that satisfies x is zero matrix. Okay, therefore x is not the minimal polynomial, but you can check that x square, A satisfies x square. In other words, if you calculate the square of this matrix, you will get a zero. Okay, therefore the least degree polynomial satisfied by A is x square. Okay, therefore this is minimal polynomial, this is characteristic polynomial. Now you take any polynomial like this, doesn't matter. Maybe as he is suggesting, we can just take P of x equal to x cube plus x square, for example. Or this is fine. Then what will be P of A? P of A will be A cube plus A square. This is equal to 0 plus 0, which is equal to 0. Correct. So this is a degree 3 polynomial satisfied by A, but this polynomial is not a scalar multiple of characteristic polynomial. Correct. So if it is a scalar multiple, then there should not be x square term. Therefore, first option is wrong. In general, you can take P of x to be x square times you take ax plus b, where b not equal to 0. Okay, so then P of A will be A square times A into A plus B. Okay, but A square is 0.
Hello.
So for speakers and network error, can you please wait?
Sami sir.
Hello ma'am.
Sir, any problem sir?
Ma'am, for speaker some network issue, maybe please stay on the line for 2 or 3 minutes.
Okay sir.
Yeah, yeah, so now I joined. I don't know, like
okay sir, okay sir.
Disconnected, I will keep talking.
Okay.
Anyway, so where was I when I was when I got disconnected? Okay, can you hear me?
But because
yes,
sir.
Sir,
it's present your screen.
Unable to see.
Okay, let me present.
Present your screen.
Okay. Okay, now screen is visible. Can you see me?
Yes, sir. It's okay, visible, so, sir.
Okay, so quickly we see option D and C, then we'll end the session. Like, suppose P has a complex root, say alpha, then its complex conjugate is also a root. And so the third root has to be a real root. If it is a polynomial of degree 3, then it should have 3 roots in the complex plane. So for real polynomials, complex root occurs in pairs. So alpha, alpha bar, beta, these are the 3 roots. Therefore, P of x can be written as x minus alpha bar into x minus beta, where beta is real. Now, this is a very important result. Minimal polynomial divides all the polynomials satisfied by A. Okay. Therefore, minimal polynomial should divide this polynomial P of x also. Okay. So, we have taken an arbitrary polynomial, degree 3 polynomial satisfied by A. We assume that P has a complex root. We claim that P equal to some scalar times characteristic polynomial. That is what we are trying to prove. So, what we have proved is minimal polynomial divides P of x. Okay, that is first thing. So, minimal polynomial divides this expression. Okay, in particular, alpha, so this implies, okay, I think we don't need this. So, this implies P of x is equal to, minimal polynomial divides P of x, right? So this implies roots of, okay, maybe what I written is right. Okay, so minimal polynomial divides P of x, that is clear. Now, like, also, what we know is every eigenvalue of the matrix A is a root of the minimal polynomial. So, why is it so? For example, if x minus 1 the whole square, x minus 2 cube, x minus 4, suppose this is the characteristic polynomial, then minimal polynomial will be of the form x minus 1 power A, x minus 2 power B, x minus power 4. Okay, so what I mean is, so whatever factors are there in the characteristic polynomial, all the factors will appear in minimal polynomial also, where this A greater than or equal to 1 and B greater than or equal to 1. Suppose if there is a 5, suppose there is a 5 here, then there will be C, where the C is also greater than or equal to 1. Okay, so every root of the characteristic polynomial appear in minimal polynomial as a root. Only the multiplicity changes. Okay, so the multiplicity, this A can be anything between, this A can be either 1 or 2. This B can be 1, 2, 3. This C can be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Anything. All possible possibilities can occur. Okay, so you can find the example of matrices for which this is the characteristic polynomial and minimal polynomial is x minus 1 power A, x minus 2 power B, x minus 4 power C, where this B is either 1 or 2. A is 1 or 2, B is 1 or 2 or 3, C is 1 or 2 or 3 or 4 or 5. For all these possibilities, you can find matrices. Okay, this is the characteristic, this is minimal polynomial. Okay, so from this result, what you can conclude is, now minimal polynomial divides P of x and every eigenvalue of A is also a root of minimal polynomial. Okay, therefore we can conclude that so this implies eigenvalue, this implies characteristic root. I'll just use the notation P of x. This implies MA of x. So already MA of x is divides P of x. P of x is given by this expression, x minus alpha into x minus alpha bar and x minus beta. And P of x is a real polynomial. Okay. So if you look at the divisors, x minus alpha bar, x minus beta, So if you look at this polynomial, x minus alpha into x minus beta, this polynomial will divide this polynomial. But this polynomial is not a real polynomial. It is a complex polynomial because this alpha is a complex number. Okay. So even though this is a factor of this polynomial, this minimal polynomial cannot be this polynomial. Okay. So this is P of x. This is P of x. We know that minimal polynomial divides P of x. So the question is, what are the possibility for P of minimal polynomial? So this is one divisor of P of x. But this is not minimal polynomial, because minimal polynomial of a real matrix is a real polynomial. Okay. So the only possibility is x minus beta. This is a real polynomial. And x minus alpha into x minus alpha bar. This will be a real polynomial. This will be equal to x square minus 2 times real part of alpha plus mod alpha square. Okay. So this is a real number. This is a real number. Therefore, this is a real polynomial. And x minus alpha, x minus alpha bar, x minus beta. So this is one possible divisor. This is one possible divisor. This is one possible divisor. Therefore, what we are concluding is, we know that minimal polynomial is a real polynomial divides P of x. Then these three are the possible real polynomials that divides P of x. Okay. So therefore, this is either this minimal polynomial, or this is a minimal polynomial, or this is equal to minimal polynomial. Okay. So if this is the minimal polynomial, then we are done. Okay. Because this is degree 3 polynomial, right? So if minimal polynomial also has degree 3, that means that minimal polynomial is equal to characteristic polynomial, because minimal polynomial divides characteristic polynomial. Okay. So maybe since we are running out of time, what we do, if this is the minimal polynomial, then nothing to prove. Okay, please check. A is a n by n matrix. And if degree of minimal polynomial of x equal to n, then minimal polynomial of x equal to characteristic polynomial of x. This is because minimal polynomial divides the characteristic polynomial, and all the roots of minimal polynomial equal to all the roots of characteristic polynomial occurs as a root in minimal polynomial also. So from this result, we can conclude this. So if this is equal to minimal polynomial, then we are done. Okay. Now, what if this is the minimal polynomial? Suppose MA of x equal to x minus alpha into x minus alpha bar. Okay. So this is degree 3. Now, characteristic polynomial should be of the form x minus alpha power some a and x minus alpha bar power some b. Okay. Now, suppose, but also degree of PA of x equal to 3.
Sir,
okay.
So this implies from characteristic polynomial to minimal polynomial.
So do you have some simpler? Yeah,
sir, we already note that every eigenvalue of A is also a root of the minimal polynomial. We have eigenvalue alpha, alpha bar, beta. So minimal polynomial has also a root alpha, alpha bar, beta.
No, we don't know eigenvalues alpha, alpha bar, beta. That is the problem. Okay.
Sir, alpha, alpha bar is a root of P.
Yeah, it is a root of P, but not the characteristic polynomial. So that is why we are actually need to do this much work.
Sir, actually, what is the second option, sir?
Let me say it. So in the second option, so we saw that if P is an arbitrary polynomial of degree 3, then P need not be equal to scalar times the characteristic polynomial. But here we put one more assumption. If P has a complex root, then So if it is a, P has a complex root and P is a degree 3 polynomial satisfied by A, then P is equal to scalar times characteristic polynomial. That is what we are trying to prove. Okay, so to prove P equal to C times characteristic polynomial of A, I am doing step by step. What is the first step? So P has a complex root. Therefore, P is of the form x minus alpha bar times x minus beta. Okay. Now, minimal polynomial should divide P of x. Also, minimal polynomial is a real polynomial. Therefore, these three polynomials are the real polynomials that divides this polynomial. Therefore, minimal polynomial should be either this polynomial or this polynomial or this polynomial. If minimal polynomial is this polynomial, then by this result,
directly we can write this third one, sir. Directly. We can write minimal polynomial is x minus alpha bar, x minus beta. Because every root of the characteristic polynomial is the root of the minimal polynomial only, sir.
X minus alpha square times x minus alpha.
And bar. Also, A is a matrix of order 3.
Right.
So if we take x minus beta as a minimal polynomial, then we have only one root only.
You're right. So what is the problem?
So directly we can take now.
No, if x minus beta is the minimal polynomial, then the characteristic polynomial could be x minus beta whole cube. So these two options we have to eliminate. You understand? For example, this could be minimal polynomial and this could be characteristic polynomial. Still, all the roots are appearing here also. But this polynomial has degree 3. So, we have to eliminate these two options. That is what it is important. So, in this problem is a sort of very important problem because like here we are doing many nice calculation using minimal polynomial. Like almost these two properties we are using in the minimal polynomial, they are very important problems. Properties like every root of the characteristic polynomial should be a root of the minimal polynomial, and every polynomial satisfied by A is divisible by minimal polynomial. These two results are very important. Like that is why I thought I would do this problem. Anyway, so now you understand like these two polynomials also possible minimal polynomial, right?
Yes, sir.
So we claim that this is the only possible minimal polynomial. Suppose this is the minimum, but it is easy to eliminate this first option. So if this is the minimal polynomial, this implies A is a diagonal matrix. So that is a simple exercise because if x minus beta is the minimal polynomial, then if you substitute x equal to A here, you get A minus beta I equal to 0. This implies A equal to beta I, which is a scalar matrix. Okay, but in the problem, it is given that A is a non-diagonal matrix. Okay, therefore, definitely X minus beta cannot be minimal polynomial. Okay, so this is a contradiction. So I'm just trying to prove why X minus alpha into X minus alpha bar cannot be minimal polynomial. So suppose X minus alpha into X minus alpha bar is the minimal polynomial, then characteristic polynomial is of the form x minus alpha power A into x minus alpha bar power B. Okay. Here degree of P of x equal to 3. This implies A is strictly greater than 1 or B is strictly greater than 1. Okay. If both of them are equal to 1, then degree of P of x will be 2. So suppose A equal to 2. Okay. Then alpha occurs 2 times. Okay, so if A equal to 2, then x minus alpha bar into x minus alpha. Correct? This is how P A of x should be equal to this polynomial, right? If A equal to 2, if A equal to 2, then P should be equal to 1, right? Because degree is 3. So P A of x should be equal to x minus alpha into x minus alpha into x minus alpha bar. But this is a complex polynomial. Why? Because this polynomial will have real coefficient. We saw that x minus alpha into x minus alpha bar will have real coefficient, but a real polynomial multiplied by a complex polynomial. So this alpha is a complex root, okay, like x proper x plus iy where y not equal to 0. Therefore, a real polynomial times some complex polynomial. So this is a complex polynomial. Polynomial with a complex coefficient. So this is a contradiction. Okay, so a equal to 2 is not possible. Similarly, b equal to 2 also, you will get the same contradiction. Because if you have, you will get x minus a, x minus alpha, x minus alpha bar into x minus alpha bar. So x minus alpha into x minus alpha bar will be a real polynomial into x minus alpha bar is a complex polynomial. So product will be complex polynomial. But the characteristic polynomial of a real matrix is a real polynomial. So that is again a contradiction. Okay. So minimal polynomial cannot be x minus alpha into x minus alpha bar. That is the reason. So if alpha occur 2 times, then alpha bar will also occur 2 times. Therefore, 4 roots will be there. That is the reason. So we get this is also not possible. So the only possibility is this is the minimal polynomial. So p of x should be equal to the minimal polynomial. But once minimal polynomial equal to degree of the matrix, minimal polynomial should be equal to the characteristic polynomial. That is immediate, because every root of the characteristic polynomial is also a root of the minimal polynomial. Okay, so we conclude that minimal polynomial of a equal to characteristic polynomial of a is equal to x minus alpha into x minus alpha bar into x minus beta. Okay, so we assumed that minimal polynomial is equal to p of x. We conclude that characteristic polynomial is also p of x. Okay, see, we have assumed that, so we assumed p of x equal to this polynomial, and we proved that minimal polynomial is also p of x. Also, we proved that minimal power to characteristic polynomial. Okay, therefore, f x equal to ma of x equal to pa of x. So, we know that characteristic polynomial of a equal to x minus alpha into x minus alpha bar into x minus beta. In particular, p of x equal to characteristic polynomial. So we get the second option is true. Now third option is immediate. If p has a complex root, then a is diagonalizable over c is immediate, because if p has a complex root, then this equation is true. This equation says that a has 3 distinct eigenvalues in the complex plane. So if it has 3 distinct eigenvalues, then it is diagonalizable over c, right? Therefore, option 3 is also true. Okay, so I will share the notes. You go through it. If you have some doubts, you can just ask me in the WhatsApp group. Okay. Yeah, it is one problem in which a lot of interesting ideas are there. So please go through it and you ask me your doubts. If you have some doubts, you can ask me quickly in a couple of minutes.
Okay, sir, I do not have doubt particular in this, but I need to ask the. There are some questions the entrance exam we could quickly ask, like when a to the power n is equals to identity, then some equations involving the matrices, right? How do we solve them? Because I really want your suggestion.
It depends on what they are asking. Like many times, if a power n equal to identity, then x power, see, okay, I'll tell you, there is a canonical way of solving such problems. Yeah. So x power n minus 1 is the characteristic polynomial, right?
Yeah.
So then, you know this cyclotomic fields, cyclotomic polynomials.
X to the power minus, q to the power xi and something.
All right, I will show you. So you have to know cyclotomic polynomials. So with the help of cyclotomic polynomials, we can solve those problems, because we know the minimal polynomials. So these are all cyclotomic fields. So if you see what is it? So the nth cyclotomic polynomial is a unique irreducible polynomial with integer coefficient that is a divisor of x power n minus 1. Okay, so that is important. So it divides x power n minus 1 and is not a divisor of x power k minus 1 for any k less than n. And its roots are primitive nth root of unity. Okay, so for example, here they have given examples of first 30 cyclotomic polynomials. So using cyclotomic polynomials, you can guess the you can guess the
minimal
polynomial. Yeah, it depends on the number n. For example, if you look at this x power n minus 1 is equal to product d divides n phi d of x, where phi d of x is the dth cyclotomic polynomial. Okay, so it depends on the number. Suppose if it is a prime number p, okay, then d equal to 1 is the 1 and p are the only possibility, right? So so using that we can do lot of things. So cyclotomic polynomial is the one important thing regarding the polynomial satisfying a power n equal to I. Yeah, regarding the matrices satisfying a power n equal to I, it will be very helpful. So I mean, again, like, you can share the questions in the WhatsApp group, we can discuss.
Sir, in previous NBHM exams, it is asked sometimes, like, so I really want to ask that, do you have make any videos over your YouTube regarding that problems? Like in 2000?
Regarding this 2000? Yeah, regarding which year?
2016 NBHM, they asked the problem, like, A belongs to N3, then A power 4 is equals to identity, then...
Right. Yeah, I remember, yeah. Like A4. Yeah, okay. So, yeah, I was doing only CSR mainly, but maybe okay. I'll do NBHM also, yeah. But in NBHM itself, there are many such problems, like that I have done. So,
yeah, there is a problem. Definitely.
Like, yeah, regarding A power n equal to I, and there is a one problem I did. And in that problem, I have discussed how to deal with, you can check in the channel. Yeah. Mm. I will share the link in the WhatsApp.
Sure.
Okay. So if you have some questions, please share in the WhatsApp group. We can discuss. Yeah, maybe I'll stop here.
Okay, Arun, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Thanks for the second opportunity.
Okay. Arun,
thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Thank you,
Arun. Thanks.